For this installment of the anaesthetic assessment, let's go through previous anaesthetic issues, postoperative nausea and vomiting, and the family history. So I really want to try and shed some light on the subtleties of history taking and how to think like an anaesthetist. I hope this will give you a jump start and speed up your learning curve when it comes to your first few months as an anaesthesia doctor. The first thing I do is check past anaesthetic records. This gives me a wealth of information about how the patient tolerated all aspects of the anaesthesia, surgery, and the immediate recovery period. Now, there are things in the anaesthesia record that I always have a close look at. First, if there's any obvious notes or warnings, this is the best indication that something out of the ordinary has happened. If something disastrous occurred, it's very rare that the anaesthetist would not have written a note or provided a letter to the patient. So there's always a record of how the airway was managed and if there was any difficulty. Often this can be really, really detailed. For example, I'll note whether bag mask ventilation was easy or difficult, what kind of airway device was used, if it was a laryngeal mask airway, the size, type, and if there are any leaks. And if I intubated the patient, what was my view of the larynx? I'll put in a link to the summary of the Cormac-Lehane grading system down below. I want to write down what endotracheal tube I needed, the size, and if I needed any assistance with a video laryngoscope, a bougie, external laryngeal manipulation, or anything else. Next, I look at the very start of the vital signs chart. The details of the induction of anaesthesia is recorded here at the very start. I look closely at a few things. I look closely at the medications that were given and the dose. I then look at whether, one, did the blood pressure drop substantially and how much vasopressor was given. For example, most young patients will be given up to 200 milligrams of propofol, and it'd be rare to have a blood pressure drop below 80 systolic and more than a few doses of metaraminol given. But imagine if a patient was given only 50 milligrams of propofol and the blood pressure also fell somewhere low like 50. And multiple doses of metaraminol and ephedrine were given. I would be incredibly careful with my induction for this patient in the future and might even change the plan altogether. Needless to say, if I ever see adrenaline prescribed on an anaesthetic record, that would be a serious red flag to stop and find out exactly what happened. Finally, I look at the post-anaesthesia recovery record. This gives me a wealth of information about how much pain and nausea the patient had, how it was treated, and also prompts me to consider if I can change my anaesthetic to minimize these problems for the future. Obviously, there's a lot of information on the record, but these are the really high-yield things to observe when you're starting out. So, chatting to the patient. When I ask my patient that first question, whether they've had any problems with any prior anaesthetic, it's really a screening question to uncover any rare but life-threatening conditions, or something less serious but still very important to the patient that might substantially improve their perioperative progress this time. Here are some of the common responses I get and how I approach them. For example, the patient might say, "I've had no problems." This is the most common response. Anaesthesia in developed countries is incredibly safe, so this is the answer I expect. Your patient might say that they've had severe pain. This occasionally happens, and it's our job to dig deeper. I won't go into all the complexities of pain management, but this will prompt me to find out whether I can do anything to make this operation less painful on this occasion. I will delve into whether the patient has a chronic pain syndrome or has risk factors for chronic post-surgical pain. What was the pain management regime the last time, and is this operation likely to cause more pain? And can I improve the pain management plan this time? Every now and again, the patient might say they had trouble waking up from the anaesthetic. In my experience, this is rarely something that's serious, and just that a patient probably took a little bit longer to be completely alert after the anaesthetic. But I do check for any inherited conditions, and more on that later. Sometimes a patient will say something like, "My heart stopped or I almost died." Now, there's obviously a very serious issue and something to escalate immediately to your supervisor. The approach I take is to find as many details as I can. I gather information from as many sources to find out exactly what happened. I check the previous anaesthetic record, as mentioned, chat to the family members, the previous anaesthetist, or the surgeon. The result of this can be anything from immediate postponement of the surgery and investigation of the patient's heart and other things, to finding out that the episode was probably idiosyncratic and to proceed with caution. But this is definitely a decision to be discussed with your supervisor. One of the most common side effects of anaesthesia and surgery, and a major cause of patient distress and prolonged recovery, is postoperative nausea and vomiting, often abbreviated to PONV. So I specifically ask if my patient has had PONV after any anaesthetic. If they say yes, you really need to get out the details. I want to know the time course. Was it one vomit in recovery, or did it go on for hours or even days? Did the previous anaesthetist know about it, and how did they treat it? With these answers, I'll be able to escalate my management depending on the risk and severity. Now, this organization called the Society for Ambulatory Anesthesia, or SAMBA, has some really comprehensive guidelines which I will link to in the notes. Finally, I want to know if any family members had any issues with anaesthesia. There's only a few major problems that I inherited. These include malignant hypothermia, pseudocholinesterase deficiency, and some congenital cardiac conditions. Many patients will know that this problem runs in their family's bloodline. So again, even though it's a low yield question, you do not want to overlook these life-threatening conditions. So that's a brief rundown on the past anaesthetic history. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please check out the other videos on anaesthesia assessment for more tips and tricks.